Social cohesion is the glue that holds society together, but that in itself is a very fuzzy concept. It's very abstract and it's very emotive. So we can think of it vertically as harmonious citizens, harmonious relationships between citizens and the state. We can think of it as horizontally as harmonious relationships between people and groups and individuals. And again, it's basically about coexistence and harmony.
So social cohesion in our joint regional program, Dialogue for the Future, is related to the quality of relationships in a society. So when we were in our program design phase, we understood that it's, of course, a very complex social phenomenon. And many social research came very useful to understanding and embedding the social cohesion in the nature of the activities that we are implementing. So when I talk about social cohesion, for us, it's about connectedness, it's about the quality of social relations, and it's about focus on the common good. And more specifically, it's also in that realm about civic engagement, participation. It's about trust and in people, trust in institutions, acceptance of diversity. It's about volunteerism, it's about solidarity. It's certainly about this perception of fairness as well.
For Swiss Development Cooperation, we kind of decided that we want to have an approach that is not defining social cohesion too much, because we think social cohesion is something that needs to be very contextualized, that needs to be localized also. So we have a very broad kind of definition where we think it's about supporting social capital, about supporting social inclusion, and then also about social mobility. And kind of this is what we think, where in broad terms, social cohesion can happen. But we don't want to go any further because we think it needs to be contextualized.
Social cohesion is a state of affairs between state and society, but also interactions among social groups based on a set of common norms and values such as trust, a sense of belonging, a willingness to participate and take action for the common good.
So the resilience and resilience capacities can be very contextual, but we see in the empirical evidence that growth mindset is a very cross-cutting resilience capacity. Growth mindset means that do we believe that we're born with talents and skills? Or do we believe that we can develop our talents and skills? So if we believe that we can develop our talents and skills and we have a growth mindset, we have a more optimistic attitude towards life, more optimistic attitude towards our relationships and our context. So we can take agency and responsibility as a citizen. Whereas if we don't have a growth mindset, we feel trapped, we feel defensive, we feel like we cannot take any agency and have control over our destinies. And social cohesion depends that we have a common destiny. It calls for a common future and common values and sharing that. So this concept and capacities for resilience can be very contextual, from property to knowing how to cook, but can be really about our understanding and approach to adversity and how we deal with adversity in daily life, which brings a mental health, actually, mental well-being. And that's one thing that we often forget. We forget the individual in the collective, in the group, in peace and in society. But at the end of the day, if it's about human relationships, we need to be healthy humans. We need mental health and well-being to be able to function as good citizens. Then the trends we're seeing, that constructive citizenship is becoming more and more important. Life skills are becoming very important in terms of how we deal with stressors, how we deal with adversity, how we deal with conflict, how we solve problems in our communities, and what are the capacities and the competences we have to bounce back. Because social cohesion in itself, without being tested with a stressor, is not very meaningful. We can find social cohesion in small, homogeneous rural communities, but what about when we're facing a stressor? Can we remain cohesive? Can we deal with stressors? So that brings in the concept of resilience. So the trends are life skills, concept of resilience, and constructive citizenship.
What we have been, doing in Eastern Africa was to look at the regional dimension of social cohesion, because we found out that most research was focusing largely at national level. So for us, we were interested in the sub-regions, because these nations do not operate in vacuums, neither do communities. Communities build up nations, nations build up the sub-regions, and from there you move up to the continental level. So 2 years ago, 2016 to be precise, we made an assessment of the state of social cohesion in Eastern Africa. And we had some, you know, interesting findings as to where countries were, and we had to go back and present these findings to our member states, and we felt that they were, you know, broadly generally received. At the time when we conducted the research, there was not much to work on. I think a conference such as this one, I found it very useful, because research in this area, it's actually very, very important, but it's an area that we have neglected. We have tended to focus on economic development, but social cohesion, you know, is equally important to economic development and to development cooperation.
We can decide. Either it's a buzzword and it will go away again, or it is really something that can help us, for example, to implement the SDGs. And it could be a good concept to help integrate a lot of different things that we do and give an overall meaning to it. And when I observe how Switzerland is actually using social cohesion, this is what I see. Switzerland often uses it in country strategies as an overall goal of everything that we do or we support.
In the Arab region, I mean, if I were to identify three specific trends, I think we've been witnessing increasing sense of alienation towards state and state institutions in specific countries. There is also an increasing use of political violence to renegotiate the existing social contract among the social groups, but and with also the ruling political elite. But the third positive trend is that we've also been witnessing more interactions between in-groups and what are classified as out-groups, less geographic boundaries, more interactions on social media even, so negative stereotyping of the other from a different community or a group is diminishing, or at least is not being dictated by one authority or a media, etc.
There's a very specific example from Liberia that economic growth, if it doesn't come with development cooperation that incorporates social cohesion, can be at odds with peace building and with social cohesion. So if you're building roads and infrastructure for economic growth without really understanding how that can affect social cohesion in terms of epidemics, diseases spreading, criminality, because road networks can have a negative effect on social cohesion while driving economic growth because of markets and trade. So we need, it gives us this holistic lens to understand why are we doing the things we're doing and how are we doing it, because we know what we want to achieve. We want to achieve democratic societies, we want to achieve peaceful societies, we want to achieve prosperous societies, but at what expense? And at the expense of at the expense of human relationships. So it brings it in a holistic framework and gives us purpose.
Many studies have now seen linkages between social cohesion and development, in the sense that societies that enjoy a high level of social cohesion tend to have a higher trust among people and in the institutions, tend to also be richer, tend to be more peaceful. And for us, certainly, you know, we always recall the preamble of the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda that talks about there is no sustainable development without peace and no peace without sustainable development.
There are so many links between social cohesion and what we already do. There is a link to peace and state building. there is a link to poverty eradication. There is a link to working on inequalities. There is a link to a lot of dimensions, you know, from this vertical and horizontal aspects of societies. And I think everywhere there is a hugely important link to development. So it's almost everywhere.
In one of my interventions here today, I was talking about where I see the entry points. Personally, I think the SDGs would be a very interesting entry point. But other than that, issues of poverty, issues of inequality, they are very important. And these are areas that development cooperation focuses on. And I think while there's been a lot has been done, still more efforts need to be done. This morning I was reading a report by the director of the SDG Center for Africa. He was saying that, where he was quoted as saying that Africa needs an incremental budget of 800 billion to realize the SDGs by 2030. So I think efforts such as those, you know, while listening out to feelers like this, it's important that development cooperation focuses on the SDGs, because this is where what everybody's trying to achieve. Yeah.
I mean, for us as a development agency, social cohesion as an operational and actionable framework actually allows us to look beyond the generic work and frameworks of peace building and conflict prevention. It allows us to really address lower level of intergroup dynamics, issues that have been once not addressed or avoided or ignored, such as trust, emotions, perceptions. So whether it's a threat perception, whether it's a perception towards justice, are being revisited and integrated as part of our objectives as a development agency.